Okay, good morning to everyone.
Good morning, sir.
Today we are going to discuss about the pump filters. So according to syllabus, we have two filters. It is the FIR filter and IIR filters. So here we begin with the concept of design of FIR filters. So here we are going to discuss the characteristics of practical frequency, selective filters, symmetric and anti-symmetric FIR filters, design of linear phase FIR filters using windows. So these concepts, what we are going to learn, it is the windows. So it is the seventh experiment what we have. Okay, so we are going to discuss those things, okay, in the lab also. Then design of FIR filters using frequency sampling method. Then we have some structures of these FIR systems. So those structures categorized into direct form, cascade form, and lattice structures. The lattice structures, they simply look like the butterfly diagram what we learned in previous concept. Okay, and the direct form and cascade form, they are similar to your network subject, the network how you're going to design the node-to-node connections. So those things will be there in direct form and cascade forms. Let us begin with the characteristics of practical frequency selective filters. So as we know the filters are there of four types. One is the low pass filter, high pass filter, band pass filter, and band reject filters. So here, while designing such filters, we must concentrate on what is the practical frequency selective. So we need to choose the frequency for the cutoff frequency what we need to design. Okay, now we need to select that one for a particular filter. So in the design of frequency selective filters, the desired filter characteristics are specified. Characteristics are specified in the frequency domain in terms of desired magnitude and phase response of the filter. So what here we are just selecting a filter based on the frequency domain, which is going to give the desired magnitude and phase response. Okay, we need to expect that particular magnitude, desired magnitude and phase response from that filter. So in the filter design, it determines the coefficients of causal FIR or IR filter that closely approximates the desired frequency response specifications. Remember, it is not possible to get the accurate answers, okay, from the circuit, from the filter, but we need to have a close approximation about the desired frequency response from the filter. So here the equations which are related to the filtering process, the selection of a filter based on the frequency, the equations are similar to the difference equations. Okay, what we have a discussion on difference equation, what we learned in mathematics, difference equations. So output Y is equal to the input X and its internal delays. Okay, because there is a feedback in the system. So what we are going to get, we are going to get output with respect to the function of input and samples of outputs. Okay, so based on that one, so here we are going to purely the filter equation is going to be considered as a difference equation. So the coefficients what we are going to use for Y and X, those are coefficients, determine the coefficients of a causal FIR or IR filter. Okay, so the issue of which type of filter to design, it is finite impulse response FIR or infinite impulse response, IAR, depends on the nature of the problem and on the specification of the desired frequency response. Okay, so based on which we need to consider FIR or IR, it will depend on the specifications of the desired frequency response. As we observed from our discussion with respect to FIR and IR of the previous sections, okay, maybe in lab, the difference equation, okay. So here, the ideal filters are non-causal and hence physically unrealizable for real-time signal processing applications. So ideal filters are non-causal and hence physically unrealizable for real-time signal processing application. What is this causality? So causality implies that the frequency response characteristics, H omega, capital H omega, that is nothing but frequency response characteristic of the filter cannot be zero. The frequency response characteristics, H omega, of the filter cannot be zero. So such filters are considered as causal filters. Okay. So except at a finite set of points in the frequency range. So in addition, the frequency response characteristic, that is H omega, cannot have an infinitely sharp cutoff from passband to stopband. So you have come to know these discussions when I show a particular diagram about a particular filter. It may be low pass, high pass, band pass, or band reject. Okay, so the frequency response characteristic H omega cannot have an infinite sharp cutoff from passband to stopband. That is, this H omega cannot drop from unity to zero immediately. So what we are going to observe, obviously, if you had an experience of these filters in the lab, you come to know, yes, there is no sudden increase or decrease between the levels. Okay, so what we are going to do is I go for the pass band or stop band. So the moment where after the cutoff frequency, at the cutoff frequency, what we are going to observe. So at that particular cutoff frequency, there is no sudden increase or decrease in the levels. Okay, so they are going to go linearly or exponentially. There is a linear growth or linear decrease in the characteristics. So that is the thing what they are going to talk about, the frequency response. That is, for the particular cutoff frequency, yes, I have selected a cutoff frequency, that is FC. So what is the condition? So at that point, based on the filter design, what we need to design, so it should perform according to our ideal conditions, but it is not possible. Okay, so the same thing is going, they are going to talk about the frequency response characteristic H omega. It is cannot drop from unity to zero or zero to unity. So by seeing this diagram, you have come to know, yes, it is a low pass filter. By seeing this diagram, you can analyze, you can yes, it is a low pass filter. Okay, the cutoff frequency, the frequencies which are less than cutoff frequency, all are allowed to pass through the system. The frequencies which are above the cutoff frequency, they are not allowed to pass through the system or the device or the filter. Okay, so the filtering process is going to happen in the low pass filter. It is going to allow only low frequency values, which are lesser than the desired frequency, the selected frequency of the filter. So by seeing this diagram, you will come to know what is that characteristic, frequency response characteristics. So which processes, processed by the ideal filters may be desirable, they are not absolutely necessary in most practical applications. If we relax these conditions, it is possible to realize causal filters that approximate the ideal approximate the ideal filters as closely as we desire. But here we are trying to get the desired conditions of the filter. So even though it is not possible to get, but we are trying to get a close approximation as we desire. So in particular, it is not necessary to insist that the magnitude, that is frequency response characteristics, magnitude of H omega be constant in the entire passband of the filter. So what we are going to achieve here, it is, so as we are, it is not possible to get a fine tune of the particular filter. So what we are desiring, the magnitude of H omega be constant in the entire passband of the filter. If a small amount of ripple in the passband, means passband is nothing but what? If the frequencies are allowed pass through the device or the system. So that particular condition is nothing but the passband. So what we are achieving, what is our desired, now the requirement is, we need to have maintain the H omega, it must be constant, that is magnitude of that one, over the frequency. Okay, but here what we are observing here, it has some ripples, passband ripples. There is a slight variation. How it is varying? Here it is varying between higher amplitude and lower amplitude values. What are those ripple amplitudes? It is 1 plus delta 1 and 1 minus delta 1. So actually what is our requirement? It is delta 1. It is a constant value what we are requiring, what we require. But what is happening due to the these conditions of the circuit, we are getting a frequency response. It has a ripple by 1 plus or minus value 1. So it is 1 plus delta 1, 1 minus delta 1. There is a variation. Actually, we need a straight curve. But what we are getting, it is a variations. Bouncing effect, what we are going to observe. Okay. So this is the thing what we need to make it correct. So we need to bring this ripples closely as we desire. So our requirement is straight line, but here we are getting ripples. How we can avoid these ripples? How we can? So if it is based on some conditions, okay, a small amount of ripple in the passband. So there is a condition is that if it is a very, very small ripple in the passband, it is usually tolerable. Okay, we can neglect that ripple if it is a small thing. Okay. Similarly, it is not necessary for the filter response to be zero in the stop band. Similarly, if I go for the stop band, nothing but wave, the frequency is above or the jump from high state to low state in the filter responses, here is not necessary, it must be a zero immediately. So if the signal is moving from high state to low state, what is going to happen? It is not immediately get its desired value, that is zero, even though there is a bouncing effect what we can observe here. So once the signal is moving from high state to low state, immediately there is a drop in the voltage level or the amplitude. Okay, here we are going to observe, once again we are going to observe there is a bouncing effect. Okay, the transition of the frequency response from the, and similarly if it is a small ripple in the stop band also, if it is a small amount of ripple in the stop band, it is also tolerable. If it is a small thing, if it is a huge not acceptable value of the ripple, obviously we need to tune this filter. Once again, we need to check what is the components, what we are using, or the frequency selection process. It must be, once again, we need to begin with. If it is a huge amount of ripple, not acceptable value. If it is a very, very small, we can neglect those ripples. So the transition of this frequency response from pass band to stop band defines the transition band or the transition region. So actual condition of the filter is what? What is our requirement? So here we need sudden change. The filter should not wait for any time duration. Immediately, if it is the frequency is, okay, what is the cutoff frequency of my filter? If it is a low pass. So all the frequencies which are lesser than the cutoff frequency, all should pass through the system. All are allowed. If the frequency, incoming frequency, it is greater than the cutoff frequency, immediately I need to make it zero. Means what? No output should come from the device. So, but it is not going to happen. There is a transition period from high state to low state. Or it is in the low pass. If you go for the high pass, there is a transition state from low pass to, from low state to high state. Okay. If you go for band reject and band pass, you are going to observe both the bands. Okay. Low to high, high to low in both the cases. So then what we are trying here, the transition time, it should be less square according to our requirement. But it is not going to happen because it is, that is the problem we are discussing now. So how to resolve such things? So it is the transition band what we are going to name, which is there between two states. Okay. Now it is a transition region of the filter. So the band edge frequency, band edge frequencies are named as WP for pass band, and it is omega P and omega S. Stop band and pass band, band edge frequencies define the edge of the pass band, while omega S denotes the beginning of stop band. So the transition duration is in between the frequency omega S and omega P. So between these frequencies, actually there is a cutoff frequency. Okay. So it is going to be live at middle of this transition band. It is FC what we are going to call. Okay, in the filter notations, FC. So it is in between the band edge, that is pass band edge and stop band edge. Thus, the width of the transition band is WS omega S minus omega P. So this is the overall width of the transition band. Obviously, we need what? We need to minimize this band width. So the width of the pass band is usually called called the bandwidth of the filter. The width of the pass band is usually called bandwidth of the filter. So this is going to be called as bandwidth of the filter. This width. For example, if the filter is low pass, will the pass band edge frequency omega P, its bandwidth is omega P itself, because it is beginning from zero. So higher frequency minus lower frequency. So it is omega P minus zero is nothing but one, omega P itself. So this one is the bandwidth of the filter. This is omega P. Then, if there is a ripple in the pass band of the filter, its value is denoted as delta 1, and the magnitude is represented as the magnitude of h of omega, which is this ripple, as we discussed, it is varied between limits 1 plus or minus delta 1. The ripple in the stop band of the filter is denoted as delta 2, okay, which varies between 0 to delta 2. So this is the variation of stop band ripples. it is varies from 0 to delta 2. For fast band ripple, it is varies from 1 plus or minus delta 1. Okay, but our goal is what? We need to make it a straight line. So actual response, what we need from a filter is, we need this type of graph. So here it is omega frequency, and here it is the h of omega, that is nothing but frequency response of the filter, h of omega of the filter. So actually what we need, our desire, it is must be ideal. It is not possible to get. We need a straight line, okay, and immediate decay. This type of curve we need, but it is not possible because the filters are designed using so many components, and each component is going to contribute its own behavior, its own characteristics, and it is going to take its own time. So those timings are considered as ripples in pass band or stop band or the transition period. So to accommodate a large dynamic range in the graph of the frequency response of any filter, it is common practice to use logarithmic scale for the magnitude. Consequently, the ripple in the passband is in decibels. We are going to mention those things in the graph or in the calculation with decibel value. That is 20 log of log 10 delta 1, or 20 log of delta 1 to the base 10. And for stop band, it is 20 log of delta 2. That is the amplitude values, delta 1 and delta 2, with respect to stop band and pass band, with logarithmic scale. So here, the discussion about characteristics of practical frequency selective filters, we discuss about by selecting a particular filter. Okay, we are talking about how the variation in the frequency response and the transition period and the calculations with respect to stop band and pass band respectively. So here, any doubt regarding frequency selective filters? Practically, how we need to think about a filter? In third semester level, have you learned filters?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So in which subject you learned these filters? Maybe for first year it is not there, for basic electronics. Filters are not there. You need to learn these things obviously in a higher semester. Third semester, yaw subject ko kalthira? Filters? Any idea? At least you went through these low pass, high pass, band pass, and band reject filters?
In power electronics and analog communications.
In analog communication and power electronics, third semester level. Okay. I think you went through, have you done any experiment on these concepts?
Yes, low pass filters and high pass filters we have designed.
Okay, using op-amp.
Yes, sir. No, sir. Op-amp.
Using op-amp. Okay, low pass and high pass. You used one resistor, one capacitor, one op-amp.
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. So, by okay, having those basic ideas, I hope you got these concepts. How practically we need to think about while selecting a filter.
Okay. Yes,
that is and this is for they are going to ask this particular concept. Extend the characteristics of practical frequency selective filter for maximum it is 4 to 5 months. Okay, so you need to explain what are the conditions, how in the pass band how ripples will be there, in the stop band how ripples will be there, and what is how there is a transition region between pass band and stop band. Okay, it is general talk. Okay, but the diagram is going to talk about particularly low pass. It look like a low pass. Okay, where there is a two transitions are there. One transition is there from high to low state, but if you go for high pass, you are going to move from low state to high state. And both are there in the stop pass band reject and band pass filters. The finite impulse response filter of length M with input X of N and output Y of N is described by the difference equation. So, as we are going to have a discussion in experiment number 4, it is difference equation. Okay, we are going to talk about now symmetric and anti-symmetric FIR filters. So we begin with FIR filter of length M with input X of N and output Y of N, which is a difference equation, which is given by Y of N, output Y of N is equals to the coefficients of input for each element, X of N, V naught of X of N plus V1 of a delay. Okay, as we are going to take a feedback, so one by one element is coming. So here we are going to get b1 of x of n minus 1 up to bm minus 1 because the length of the filter is m. Okay, this bm minus 1 x of n minus m plus 1. This is going to give a summation of k is equal to 0 to m minus 1, it is the coefficients of each element of x, that is bk, x of n minus k, where bk is the set of filter coefficients. Okay. Alternatively, we can express the output sequence as the convolution of the unit sample response h of n of the system with the input signal X of N. So with the unit sample response h of n, we can get the convolution of the two signals. Means we can represent the above equation as a convolution of two signals. One is input signal x of n, and another one is the system impulse response. Okay, that is h of n. So we may write the output is nothing but summation of k is equal to 0 to m minus 1, the unit sample response h of k and the circular shift of x of n minus k. Make the lower and upper limits on the convolution sum reflects the causality and finite duration characteristics of the filter. So these two equations are identical in form, and hence it follows that bk is nothing but hk. That is what the coefficients, the set of filter coefficients are nothing but what? The impulse response of the filter, that is h of n. that k ranges from 0 to m minus 1, that is length of the filter. So the filter can also be characterized by its system function by using the jet transform that is given by the standard equation with the impulse response. It is h of z, which is equal to summation k is equal to 0 to m of minus 1 h of k. It is z to the power minus k, or inverse of z to the power k, which we view as a polynomial of degree m minus 1 in the variable z to the power minus 1. The roots of this polynomial constitute the zeros of the filter. So we can write an FIR filter as a linear phase if its unit sample response satisfies the condition h of n is nothing but plus or minus h of capital M minus 1 minus of n, where n ranges from 0 to m minus 1. When the symmetry and anti-symmetry conditions in the above equation, that is the linear phase of the FIR filter, its unit sample response satisfies this condition, that is h of n, which is equal to plus or minus h of capital M minus 1 minus n. Okay. Then if we add this one in the above equation, 8.2.4, if we add it in 8.2.3, then we can realize a capital H of Z, which is nothing but, if I expand that one by putting all k values, it is H of 0 plus H1, Z to the power minus 1, H of 2, Z to the power minus 2, and up to H of M minus 1, because k ranges from 0 to m minus 1. So if it is k is up to h of m minus 1, z to the power minus m minus 1. If we substitute 8.2.4 in 8.2.3, what we are going to get? If I take the common terms, that is z to the power minus m minus 1 by 2, which is given by h of m minus 1 by 2 plus summation n is equal to, for odd sequence, summation n is equal to m minus 3 by 2 h of n, and it is z to the power m minus 1 minus 2 k by 2 plus or minus z to the power minus m minus 1 minus 2 k by 2. Okay, for m odd, for m is equal to even, then we may get the same equation will be z to the power minus m minus 1 by 2, summation n is equal to 0 to m by 2 minus 1, h of n into z to the power m minus 1 minus 2 k by 2 plus or minus z to the power minus of m minus 1 minus 2 k by 2. For odd term, there is a small correction, and between the difference between odd and even is, here the h of m minus 1 by 2 appears for odd sequence, it does not appear in even sequence. Okay, the summation ranges for odd, it is m minus 3 by 2, but for even, it is m by 2 sequence. Okay. Obviously, so here it is the minimized version what it is displaying, but you need to try how to get this one by substituting these 2.4 into 2.3, okay, by satisfying this condition. Now, if we substitute z to the power of minus 1 for z in this equation, what 8.2.3 they are talking about, and multiply both sides of the resulting equation by z to the power minus of m minus 1, we may get it is z to the power of minus 1 subtract z to the power minus 1 for z. Okay, instead of taking z, we are going to consider z to the power minus 1. And both sides, if we multiply by the equation z to the power minus of m minus 1, we may get 8.2.3 as z to the power minus of m minus 1 h of z to the power minus 1. I am just replacing z by z to the power minus 1, which is nothing but plus or minus h of z. When h of l is given by h of m minus 1 minus of n, the h of omega, that is the frequency response characteristic, h of omega can be expressed as h of omega, which is equal to hr of omega e to the power minus j omega m minus 1 by 2, where hr of omega is the real function of omega and can be expressed as the real function for odd and even categories. It is given by, because it is e to the power minus j omega m minus 1 by 2, because it is a complex value. It is a complex term. So hr of omega, which is given by for odd sequence of m, it is h of m minus 1 by 2 plus 2 into summation n is equal to 0 to m minus 3 by 2 h of n cos omega, the real part of the total factor. Cos of omega, this m minus 1 by 2 minus of yeah. And for even, if m is even number, then the real function of omega is given by hr of omega, it means odd, we are not going to consider this term, h of m minus by 2 for even condition. And this summation is going to end with m by 2 terms because it is even. Okay, it is 2 into n is equal to 0 to m by 2 minus 1 h of n cos omega of m minus 1 by 2 minus of n. So the phase characteristics, it is what? It is the amplitude what we have discussed. The real value of the real function of omega, that is h omega, 8.2.7, it is the amplitude of the filter. And what about the phase characteristics of the filter for both m odd and m even? It is given by eta of omega equals to minus of omega m minus 1 by 2. And it is for if the real function of omega, hr of omega, is greater than 0. And if it is less than 0, then the phase characteristics are given by minus of omega into m minus 1 by 2 plus pi. When h of n, if it is anti-symmetric, if it is a symmetry, h of n is given by h, if we consider in the symmetry, h of n is equal to h of m minus 1 minus n. If it is, then h of n is equal to minus of h of m minus 1 minus of n. The unit sample response is anti-symmetry. For m odd, the center point of the anti-symmetry h of n is n is equals to m minus 1 by 2, which is equals to 0. However, if m is even, each term in h of n has a matching term of opposite sign. So it is straightforward to show that the frequency response of an FIR filter with an anti-symmetric unit sample response can be expressed as the h of omega for anti-symmetric unit sample response. H omega is the real function of omega, hr of omega, into e to the power j minus of omega m minus 1 by 2 plus pi by 2. What is the difference between these two? It is, here it is, for symmetry, hr of omega into, what is the total factor, exponential term, e to the power minus j omega m minus 1 by 2. Here it is, minus of omega m minus 1 by 2 plus pi by 2. Where? Here it is, the hr of omega is equals to 2 times of summation n is equal to m minus 3 for odd sequence of m. It is m minus 3 by 2 h of n sine omega m minus 1 by 2 minus of m. Similarly, for even sequence, it is 2 times of summation n is equal to 0 to m by 2 minus 1 h of n sine omega m minus 1 by 2 minus of m. Okay, the term that is going to be there here in the antisymmetry for even m and odd m, it is the summation of n. It is going to end up with m minus 3 by 2 and m by 2 for odd and even respectively. So the phase characteristics. So what we got, it is the 8.2.11, it is an antisymmetry condition for this, the magnitude of this frequency response, magnitude of the filter. Similarly, the phase characteristics of the filter for both even and odd values of m, it is given by theta of omega is equals to, for hr of omega it is greater than 0, then it is pi by 2 minus of omega m minus 1 by 2. If hr of omega is less than 0, it is given by theta of omega is nothing but 3 pi by 2 minus of omega m minus 1 by. So these general frequency response formulas can be used to design linear phase FIR filter with symmetric and antisymmetric unit sample responses. So this concept is about symmetric and antisymmetric FIR filters with magnitude values h of omega and phase characteristics theta omega. First, we deal with by using these things, magnitude and phase characteristics, how we can design a linear phase FIR filter using different windows. So in the next class we discuss this. And same thing we are going to observe in the large experiment 7. Okay, how they are working. Okay, how we need to go for, how there is a variation, the difference in the windows. Okay, different windows are going to give different frequency responses for a filter. So we'll meet in the next class. Have a nice day. Thank you.